The fourth issue which I want to dwell is the increasing water conflicts, which is, I think, you know, which is, I mean, I don't think we need to describe that, you know. In fact, it's one of the interesting, thing which I quote is that when Priyaranjan's Munshinji was the water resource minister of the center, he made a comment saying that he is not a minister for water resources, but he is a minister for water conflicts, especially looking at the whole interstate conflicts, if you look at any of the rivers and things. But I think the conflicts are not just transboundary conflicts or interstate conflicts. There are conflicts all around today, especially on equity, allocation, displacement, pollution issue, and various other things cutting across different scales and things. So, which is something which is, I think, in any water governance system need to address these issues and things. The WCD had this famous saying also saying that, there's a conflict between rural and urban populations because allocations are changing, upstream and downstream interests, agriculture industry and domestic sectors, human needs and requirements of a healthy environment. And so it's broadly a four-way type of thing which is talking about. There are many other types of conflicts are coming into this. The fifth issue is, I think, large dams, hydropower development and things. I think that's a very critical issue in the country today. With the WCD and things, there was an understanding that probably there may be a rethinking about, large dams and other things. In fact, there was period also people are much more critical in terms of governments or states or even funding agencies or even World Bank to some extent. But I think now we are again going to reverse gear now. There are a whole lot of funding coming on projects of this nature, larger projects and things. And we don't seem to be learning anything. Sardar Sarovar project, which was, has existed about, 30 or 35 years of struggle around that. I don't think we have learned as a society, as a state, to this. The same mistakes are being now repeated in Polavaram to some extent, the issues coming up. Sardar Sarovar itself, now the government has, or the authority has given permission to increase it to the ultimate height of about 138 or something, which is going to bring in all of issues of displacement, which cannot be even, I think we can even keep track of that. That's the type of scale of displacement which is going to take place. So this issue which we need to relook at things. Now, this is being played out in the Northeast in a much more, for example, if you just give some numbers, this is a famous quotation from Arundhati Roy about her book on greater common good, which is interesting. The millions of displaced people do not exist anymore. When history is written, they would not be in it, not even as statistics. Some of them have subsequently been displaced thrice or four times. This is a type of, in a very nutshell, she has captured the whole displacement story in the country. 40 to 50 million people displaced due to development projects, and mostly it is dams. And dams and, is the highest displacer. And most of these displaced people are asset-less and rural poor, especially tribals account for nearly 40% of the people who are displaced, and Dalits about 20%. So this is the way, we all say that for the greater common good, some people should suffer, but we know which people suffer in this whole process. There's a social dichotomy in terms of people are benefiting out of these projects and people are paying the price for it. So it's a high time that we relook at some of these issues. And this is going to come up with a new dispensation and things, which is also fond of larger projects and things. Now look at Northeast. I'm sure somebody was there from Northeast, I think. You are there, or some of you have been covering some of these stories in IWP. Now, this is a map of the Northeast. You can see the dots where all the new projects are coming up. In fact, if you look at map and Tripathi, I don't think you'll have any space left to put, this is a very interesting map which I always liked and things. Now, this is Arunachal. Arunachal has got something called 154 MOUs, which have been already signed for something about 46 or 47,000 megawatt, hydropower. In fact, I think it was Jairam Ramesh or somebody visited who said that Northeast is stuck by MOU virus because, everybody is signing MOUs for hydropower and things. Now, this one, most of them are, they say, run-of-the-river projects. But run-of-the-river project does not mean it doesn't need any empowerments. It also takes water much longer distances. There are larger stretches of river which is going to be completely dry and the entire state is going to be actually tunneled, if you are to take this type of thing. Now, the issues is that for whom this electricity is being produced. Now, there are different arguments for this. Basically, these are electricity for the Northeast to be exported to the rest of India. It's not for local needs, primarily, and things. So, we need to look at some of these developments that are taking place. There are a whole lot of huge movements around displacement. I think Northeast has now taken a new turn than the rest of India. I think massive movements. I think Arunachal, there's a case, they have never been able to even move materials because the blockade. Subhanshiri, na? From Assam to Arunachal and things. So it's a massive movement which is taking place. I think we need to engage with. When you talk about water sector issues, these are also issues which are coming up or already taking place in the country. Growing inequity and agrarian crisis, I will not get into details because I think Seema is going to have an independent take on this. There are two, three, just to park it. One is this whole unequal expansion of irrigation which is taking place. In fact, there are a whole lot of geographies within the country which is actually out of the coverage of any even, you know, assured water, what I call applied water, or a basically what you call, just to keep your crops alive. I'm not talking about, you know, green revolution agriculture or, you know, high intensive water cropping system or high intensive agriculture and things. In fact, this is called what I think, I like this word by Yugandhar, who was the planning commission member, who said, this is the poverty geography of India, basically the central western part of India, which is actually survives on rain-fed agriculture and things. So regional disparities in the development of irrigation, for example, Punjab has got something like about 80% of the area irrigation, and it is now dealing with issues of over-irrigation and various other type of things there. And in Maharashtra, though we talk about the largest number of medium and major projects, we have something like about 16 to 17% of the cropped area under irrigation today. And that's also government statistics. One of the reasons is the whole political economy of agriculture there, because, you know, most of the water is consumed by, let's say, crops like sugarcane and things, you know, which is maybe 2-3% of the area is occupied by that. Most of the water goes into that. 170 most backward districts in the country, which I call this whole, is rain-fed. And also there's an interesting study by Vaidyanathan, which has tried to analyze the, you know, whole thing, the whole expansion of irrigation. Where does it take place, actually? So expansion of the irrigated area has been much faster on larger sized farms compared to small and marginal farmers and or farms and things. And it's also quite alarming. I mean, this report, which brought out there for the first time since the mid-60s, food grain production grew slower than the population and things. So which is, I think, which we thought that we have already overcome the food crisis to a great extent. And but I think these issues are coming back again. And with larger intersectoral reallocation taking place from agriculture to industries, I think this issue of even food security is going to hit us badly over time. I mean, there's a larger, I think, beyond this, there's a larger agrarian crisis which is taking place, and the farmer suicide is only just tip of that iceberg which is taking place. There's a changes. In fact, there are studies, especially in places like Gujarat. We are all talking about Gujarat model. The extent of what I call proletarianization of the farming community which is taking place, where farmers are losing land and they're becoming laborers. And this, this rate of growth has been much phenomenal in some parts of the country, and especially Gujarat and things, where either people losing out land and becoming agricultural laborers, because even land along with what is getting used by other type of you know, uses and things. I mean, drought is another thing. Drought and floods, I think these are two realities which are growing up. I think this is something which I took from maybe one of the articles in Down to Earth, which came very late. I mean, the type of, the extent of drought, I mean, it's not only very localized or anything. This year again, we are talking about an increasing, I mean, intensified drought. I mean, 1,20,000 villages affected in terms of population, about 160 million. And these are the numbers of huge. I mean, saying that even irrespective of so much of huge investments, I mean, I think the public sector itself, people are talking about what, I don't know, 120,000 crores or something which has been, you know, invested. And apart from what people have, you know, invested in wells and various other things, which is also equally massive. Irrespective of this type of a massive investment, we still find that drought is the major, you know, reality in our areas. Even non-availability of drinking water or sanitation facilities. I mean, some of the figures has come in the 12th planning documents, actually, in the working groups and things. For example, access to safe drinking water, urban is about 95%, rural is about 82%. But we find a declining trend from 2000. We find that the coverage has been actually declining, and type of thing. After 2000, we find a, in terms of coverage. I mean, coverage itself has a problem, the way they have estimated coverage and how do they do it, things. But that their own data shows that from 2000 onwards, the coverage has been declining to some extent. And the issue and the decline has been much more serious in the rural areas in terms of drinking water. And you also have sanitation issues. There, the sanitation decline has been actually in the urban areas because of the rural poor has been migrating, and basically the sanitation facility has been, the coverage has been declining, especially in the cities. And the rural areas have been showing, maybe because of all this Nirmal Gram Abhiyan and various other type of thing which is taking place, that itself we need to critique quite a big extent, because they have this Nirmal Abhiyan Puraskar, I think, which is given, and all the villages fall back after the Puraskar is got. I mean, I think, so there are some stories of that. But I think even these basic two needs, I think drinking water and sanitation also has been a critical issue in this. Floods is another reality which we have to live with. I mean, the whole question of flood cushioning systems and dams as the, you know, things to take care of floods, or embankments. I mean, the whole structural measures to, you know, deal with floods has been failing year after year, and that has been exacerbating the issues. Now, for example, it is said that 40 to 50 million hectare, that is, I think we have a geographical area about 380 million, around that, I mean, let's say 350 million. So out of that, 40 to 50 million hectares is actually flood prone, and I think in 2010, actually flood prone affected was about 50 million hectares and things. About 812,500 crore worth of damages, I mean, it's an estimate, it's a government report, which I think has come out saying that from 53 to 2010. Through 5-year plans, we have been spending like 126,000 crores in terms of various flood, you know, management and various other types of things, basically building embankments. And I think last year, I think there was a case, I think Chiku was covered in IWP, you know, that whole Bihar case, where our friend has been sitting for, which has been said, where embankments or the rivers have been changing courses. Now the demand is that you bring them back the original river, and now a whole lot of debate about embankments which is taking place. Privatization, again, I'm not going to get into the discussion. I think tomorrow Sripath and Gaurav are going to deal with. I think there are two things which are taking place which you need to take note of. One is what I call, I mean, of course, they might articulate it differently, what I call a water source privatization which is taking place. I mean, you know, stretches of rivers are giving to companies. Shivnath was one case, or groundwater being given for bottling plants. Pachimada was another important case and things. So there are different shades of that. Or even trading of water rights, which is being, you know, Maharashtra, it is being put into place now as a system, and that is taking place. And also what I call privatization of service delivery, either through PPP or other type of things which are taking place. So these are two different types of privatization taking place. It has impacts on access to water, pricing, who gets priced out of water system and things. Related issues, pricing. So I think somebody also raised the issue of pricing today. So I think there are different takes on pricing. One was this whole concept of free service. I mean, there are many of people believe that water is a natural resource and type of thing, so it should not be priced. That is one take which we have. Or maybe part of the water can be priced like South Africa has done and things. So free water is one. Second concept is, how do you price this affordability? I mean, people, you know, should be able to afford. What is the articulation within that? You estimate your disposable income, like after meeting basic needs, and what is your disposable income, and only a fraction of that should go into your water cost of thing. The third understanding is that at least the water price should be estimated in such a way that the operation maintenance cost should come back into the system. So it's the state's responsibility to sink the capital cost in terms of building systems, dams or reservoirs or water infrastructure, but for the day-to-day maintenance or operations and things, or other things, that users should pay that thing. So I think most of the states work on this principle of, you know, saying that the operation maintenance cost should come back into the system. There is also, after the 90s, a talk about full cost recovery, saying that whatever the including the capital cost, the entire thing should come back into the system, no subsidies and things. So that is another way of looking at. And also there is something called a graded system. So when I talked about the basic service also, saying that we can have a two-way division or something between lifeline water and luxury water. The understanding is that you have a graded tariff system. So water which is going for the basic needs like drinking water and things should be priced much lower, and water for the luxury use should be other priced higher. Second, in the irrigation system also we say that water which is required for livelihood needs should be priced lower, and water which is going for surplus generation or, you know, commercial agriculture should be priced more. There are different ways of doing it. I think Vaidyanathan headed a committee on this in the 90s sometime by the central government to look at this whole pricing mechanisms and things. So this is another issue which is heating up in the water sector, so that how do you look at pricing of water. So the basic thing which we have been advocating is that basic service to be provided at an affordable cost, even part of it as free water, and economic service to be priced at full cost recovery, where the water is being used as a resource to generate, you know, surpluses or profits or other type of thing, whether it's in the agriculture, industry, bottling and various other type of sectors.
Who pays for the infrastructure?
Infrastructure what?
The whole infrastructure to deliver the water.
What, yeah.
Now, there are only two ways that it can be paid. Consumer pays, in great service, or the taxpayer pays. Your argument is that the taxpayer should pay. Perfect. That taxpayer paying is equitous. It provides equity. Taxpayer funding capital assets.
Yeah.
Has that been studied?
I don't know whether it has been studied done. So basically what I would say that whether it's a taxpayer ultimately pays, I mean there are different ways of doing it. For example, in South Maharashtra movement, demanded saying that when irrigation comes to an area, who will benefit out of it? The farmers would benefit, of course, because they can take. But they also said that even the industrial capitalists also benefit, because the purchasing power of the people increases, so the type of vehicles and other inputs which is coming from the centralized production systems also increase. So one of the demands saying that to build up this infrastructure, at least about 1 to 2% of the total outer of the industrial goods should be brought back into irrigation system, because they are also benefiting out of it. So you can also raise resources in a differential manner. It's not only through taxing or taxes the way we understand it today, but there are different ways of raising that capital amount. Ultimately, I would say it is the state's responsibility to build up the infrastructure. Second, when you say that whole lot of water is going for economic service, that is either industrial use or commercial agriculture, we are also saying that the capital costs also should come back partly. So it's not only just taxpayers' money, it is also the user pays for it. Now we are only saying that for the basic service like livelihoods water or the drinking water, there should be the capital cost should not be recovered. And there can be a system of crop subsidization, that's what's happening in other place. Why is that industrial water is always priced higher than agriculture water is that there is an element of crop subsidies. So I think there are different pricing mechanisms of raising the capital. It's not only that the taxpayers pay for it. That can be one way. So, I mean, that's what I would say. Yeah. What I would say is that the water has a role to play in terms of, that's the way how you can, the state's responsibility and things. Now, water, for example, unless you have, access to certain minimum quantities of, safe drinking water with certain quality and things, it has got much more other societal ramifications. It's not like as an individual use it and then, the whole thing stops with that. So there I think the state has to step in to provide that. Okay. Now the issue is that how do you raise that issue, the money for it. Now I would not argue that, every user should pay for, the whole full cost of that water and things. Because now tax is also seen in two ways. Now for example, there is something called a direct taxing method. Now who pays the direct taxes? I don't think it's the resource poor who pays the direct taxes. For example, the agriculture community doesn't pay direct tax. In fact, that we can relook at it, whether certain farming sections should pay tax or not, that's a different issue. But it is also people who have income above certain levels pay the direct taxes, which you pay the returns and other type of thing. Now the indirect taxes is something that anything you buy, there's a tax involved in that. If I buy a matchbox also, there is a tax in that, which everybody pays, even including the resource poor. Now there's one argument is that in many of the countries have done is that they have increased the direct taxes much higher and cut down the indirect taxes so that the resource poor sections are not hit the same way. But India, unfortunately, the direct taxes has been kept down and the indirect taxes has been going up, which has been much more serious issue today. So I think there is a whole lot of issues which you need to look at when you talk about taxation and things, and I would not agree with saying that the user of the water should pay full cost recovery, however poor he or she may be. So I think we need to look at So investment, there are 3-4 ways of coming up. Partly the user themselves pay. I'm saying that if you have a graded tariff system.
But what he's saying is, there may be mechanisms to raise that, but what he's saying is correct. Ultimately, there are only two places from which the investments can come, either the users or the tax. That is the state funding, basically. The state. And state gets its funding basically from.
But I am giving a third option, saying that if there are indirect beneficiaries of a water system or irrigation. No, but that's not state. That you are taxing the industry separately for that to raise the capital.
But
So I think we need to be innovative to raise that. Otherwise,
yeah, but I think that
yeah, you can put it for discussion. Yeah.
That
is
my point is that the arguments of pricing, only when it's focused on pricing, may actually not fulfill the objective of equity if it is not addressed in its entirety as to who invests, who pays for it, and who, how is it then priced. All three have to go simultaneously together if we want equity.
No, but then what is the implication of that in terms of actual pricing? For example, now let's say one service, yeah. How will that work out? That's what I'm saying. In practice.
Well,
what can be an approach? I mean, practically, okay, that is a little different, but how can be an approach to a different approach to pricing then?
The capital taxation effort here implicitly based itself in the argument of, let's say, the overall goal is the concept of free service. Lifetime water is free, that is covered as a good argument. And then access to recover point of cost.
From those second sections, so what do you say? Not all the, not everybody.
The state of affairs as it goes in the country, even in the document of the Bank Commission, the whole attempt is to recover just point of cost. At best. Yeah, but there's also a lot of other logic of this does a disservice to various communities who are able to create their own capital in
investment
to
create,
provide water and as a service to its own community to recover the cost from the beneficiaries of that water and actually be able to recover full capital cost. There are examples of many small projects, but this is possible. But because the veterinary or the principles and
that goes against the, some of the.
But it says that if you're recovering full cost, that you're actually doing something wrong, but it doesn't be wrong. That's the exposition, which deprives the community of its ability to create equity and provide more water and economic benefits. So I think, again, the question will come of local versus large scale, and principles which are sort of templatized for the whole nation can mitigate that these local, equitable, ecological and beneficial solutions. And we should always put a caveat on that.
I partly agree with that statement saying that this whole universalization of an approach. I think my effort was not to universalize, but I am saying that there are different ways of it. There are certain, even if you work out locally equitable or more solutions or local solution, but there should be certain upper bound. Now, for example, PIA, Participatory Irrigation Management, there's a provision that the water association can charge any charge. Even if you are talking about this principle, it doesn't operate there. The water association can charge its members or non-members a commonly decided tariff. I mean, that did not be within the what the agriculture department or irrigation department charges. So I think there are local flexibilities we need to build in for the local community. But what I would say that it should not lead to a situation where certain communities are priced out of the system. That's all. But if you say that there is a local community which is doing this and they are demanding a full cost recovery because the cost itself is maybe low because the decentralized systems and things are not bringing what to a larger infrastructure and things. And people are ready to it, then I don't think I have a problem with that. But then when you talk about a policy level discourse type of thing, then what are the basic core principles you advocate? That's what. Given the freedom to local communities to work within those things. Otherwise, I've seen now, why is that? Otherwise, there are people we talk about communities and type of thing. Why is that Dalits are priced out sometimes? So Dalits don't get access to issues, water facilities and things. We need to see that. I mean, it's not a joke that Ambedkar told the Dalits to leave the village and concentrate the powers on the villages and the cities because he said that they will never get justice in the villages. So there are larger realities. In fact, after the Godhra violence, there were villages, the Gram Panchayat passed resolutions after resolutions that Muslims should not come back into the villages. So I think these are also larger political realities which we need to live with. And also we have seen what is association, they have the freedom to do it and they have increased the water charges to some extent that people have not been able to take. So I think realities speak for both the sides. And I do agree that there may be small examples of where smaller experiments have been done in which people have been able to do with things and where this. But there are also other larger political realities when you talk about some of these entire decision making to whatever level is to be vested with at a small level because of the existing inequities within the society. If I feel that everybody is egalitarian, everybody is equal, and I don't think there's an issue here. I'm not saying that we should divorce investment from pricing. We are talking about pricing because we are sensitive saying that
should
compatible with the system. In fact, a good quality system works maybe for the resource poor better, because others have like other sources and things. In a public irrigation system, we have seen if the canals are degraded, there is no operating maintenance done, it is the tail enders who suffer. So I do agree with you on that point, but the issue is that how do you work it out? I'm not saying that none of us, at least within my or SOPECOM or other type of groups is sitting here, we are not saying that every water should be given free. We are not saying, even movements are not saying that. We are also saying that certain portion of the investment should come back. Now, in what way that investment will come back? Investment is important. In fact, agriculture investments have been declined overall. So that has impact on the resource poor sections and this. So I don't deny with that. The investment is important because if investments fall, the quality of service will fall and type of thing. But the issue is that how do you raise that resource? So what are the ways in which we can do which is much more equitable? That's all my take. So this is one way we thought that at least looking at the water pricing, maybe if you have graded tariff system, then you can price the people who use water beyond certain type of thing much larger. I mean, that we have in for other basic services. Look at, for example, electricity. If you use electricity more than a particular slab or unit, then the per unit costs do go up. Same with, telephone services and things. So we are only arguing that how do you build in a pricing system which is much more socially just, basically to bring in the investment back. So I'm not arguing that investment is not this. Maybe you can take it up later and we'll get this. I'll just run it through. Yeah, but interesting discussion. Summer paddy or sugarcane and type of thing. For example, one of the measures which is given is that if you use something like about 1 hectare millimeter water, that is about 10,000 liters of water, then in high input agriculture, the biomass, which is called dry biomass, is produced is to the tune of about 6 to 8 kg per hectare millimeter. That is, if you use 10,000 liters of water, then what it produces is about 6 to 8 or 9 kg biomass. Now, in some of the farmer managed systems and other type of thing, you have a potential, or people have achieved on an average something about 20 to 30 to 40 kgs. So what the trying to say, when you talk about water use productivity and efficiency and type of thing, it is not only about, we are talking about water wastage, that is one level. But I think what is the type of productivity you get per unit of water? I mean, otherwise we only talk about per unit of area, like per acre, how much sorghum is produced or sugarcane is produced or jowar is produced and other type of things. But it's also important that how much biomass or how much crop is produced per unit of water, and where external input agriculture is being practiced, it has been pretty low. And there is a whole lot of catching up to be done if you have to, actually increase our water use productivity. So EME had this slogan called more crop per drop, which in a way captures the spirit of that. Or some of the interesting farmers' innovations or other type of things, like system of rice intensification or other type of things, or some of the even better organic or external input sustainable agriculture systems have been able to produce much larger type of things. So SRI, I think, has been talked about as an important issue. The whole issue of reducing water footprint has become much more critical in terms of thing, whether it is agriculture, industry, and other type of sectors. And I think we need to also go beyond technical or technological fixes. Technology is important. I'm not saying that technology is important. Otherwise, when you talk about water use efficiency and other things, we only talk about drips and sprinklers and other type of thing. But there are a whole lot of other things, demand management, what you can do in terms of better efficient cropping systems, better efficient crops, agronomical practices. How do you increase the soil moisture holding capacity? Moisture holding capacity of the soil itself. There are different type of practices which are there, and we need to look at that. Otherwise, we get into this technical fixes and things.